This conference will now be recorded. This conference will now be recorded.
Hello, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning, Shiva.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning, Shiva.
Good morning, guys. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, we can able to see.
Okay, thank you. And even my audio is also good, right? Anyone has any problem hearing me?
No, no. No.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Okay. Let's get started, guys. Let me introduce myself. Okay. So we'll start with my introduction, and I'll tell you what is that we are going to cover in this specific session. Okay, and then we will take up your questions and answers. So myself, Shivaprasad, guys, I'm currently working as a cloud consultant or architect, I should say, where, you know, I deal with infrastructure builds or new infrastructure builds on AWS, not only AWS, other clouds as well, but extensively AWS. And along with this, I also work on in DevOps strategies, like building DevOps strategies, where, you know, we help clients in implementing or understanding their current situation, and then help them build the continuous integrations, continuous deployments, CI/CD, using you know, third-party tools as well as AWS or cloud native tools as well. Like Amazon also has their own tools for building the CI/CD pipeline, or I also use these things. So my expertise is more into Docker, Kubernetes, okay, and infrastructure as a code, like Terraform, is something that I have good hands-on experience on. Others also, Jenkins is also something that I work, but just to differentiate, I'm just telling you that, you know, Docker, Kubernetes, Terraform, and those things is something that, you know, now I'm using extensively for building things. So training is a part time that I do, guys. Okay, and I've been training people on various technologies from past 7+ years. Okay, so when I say different technologies, includes Linux operating systems, Windows, virtualization like VMware, and then Hyper-V, and then cloud, AWS, DevOps. Okay, these are the things that I've been training people from past 7+ years. Okay, so today we are here to discuss on AWS solution architect, right? You know, what is that we are going to do, what are the opportunities that we have and all. So I'm not sure of the crowd that has joined, guys. You can see there are, you know, 20-25+ people joined this meeting today. So since I am not aware of the crowd, okay, and I just wanted to give the generic topic so that everybody is on the same page. Okay, I believe demo is more of your session rather than me explaining something. But to set the context and all, I have some slides, like 5 to 6 slides, where I'll be talking about the cloud terminologies, okay, and why we are getting into cloud. And it will take me around 20 to 30 minutes. And after that, it's your turn, and you know, you might have some questions, okay, you might have your own doubts and all, and we can start with questions and answers. Sounds good?
Yes.
Yes, sure.
Okay, so let's get started, guys. So I'll start with some basic questions. Don't get bored, guys. Okay, some of you might know the topics that I'm talking about, that, you know, with the experience that I had in this AWS session, there are people who are from different backgrounds. Okay, just to make sure everything is on the same page, I have to cover basics to basics things here. Okay, you know, the first question that comes up before we actually get started is that, you know, what is cloud? We are here to talk about cloud now. Just, you know, I just wanted to hear a couple of responses from you. What do you think a cloud is, guys? What is a cloud from your perspective? No one?
Hi, Shiva. Yashwant here.
Hello, Yashwant.
Actually, cloud computing is something like that. We are using the remote servers and accessing them via internet to perform our own own purposes, like to publish an application over an internet. So that the remaining people can be visualize that rather than using our own servers and own infrastructure to publish them.
Yes, so the last point was important. Okay, you know, we usually access our application from a remote location, right? Which is called as a data center. It could be your office as well, right? You know, and your office data center might be somewhere in US or Philippines or Singapore. You might be sitting in India, right? And from here you are going to access this. So this is not a cloud, by the way. So anything that you access over internet is not a cloud. But the last statement that you have defined, right? This infrastructure doesn't belong to us. It is some third party providers. You don't own the infrastructure, by the way. You only rent it. You rent it for the long, as long as you want it, and you only pay for what you consume in the specific infrastructure that they are providing us. And everything happens over internet. And that is what we call as IaaS. What is this IaaS, guys? Infrastructure as a service. Okay. So yes, so couple of statements here. Not everything that we access over internet is a cloud. Okay, cloud is a kind of a remote location where we have the physical servers available, okay, which is nothing but a data center, and you as a client, you get into their data centers and then you create your own infrastructure and then you build your applications. But where does this story all started? Sorry guys, so where does the story has started, by the way? So how did we started using cloud was initially, you know, if you remember, when we started using smartphones, or at least the phones with cameras, right? When we started taking pictures, when we started listening to music over the phone, then, you know, we have the internal drives, and then we had the external memory cards. And anything that you take, the pictures, the videos, you know, the MMS that you get, all of those things, you know, we are so curious to save them, isn't it? And what we used to do, we used to copy them to our own laptops, our friends' laptops, our desktops, or within the laptop, storing it in multiple locations. How many of you done this, guys? At least I did this. How many of you did? And what was the purpose of doing that? Like saving the same copy of data onto multiple devices or the multiple locations. What was the reason behind that?
To back up the data.
To back up the data. In the sense, during the event of failures, okay, even if something happens to your mobile phone, you will still be able to access your pictures, audios, music collections and all, right? That was the whole idea that we started with, where the smartphones have come into picture. And gradually, that has moved to what, iCloud. Everyone is very much familiar with iCloud now, where you don't have to store it on your local devices, rather store it on the cloud, right? iCloud itself is a cloud. So Apple is giving you, when you use Samsung phone, they say that, okay, you can back up your data to Samsung cloud. When you use now Android phones, whenever you are using Android phones, now you can back up into your Dropboxes. You can back up into Google Drives, isn't it? So that was the whole idea of the cloud that we generally started use. The general cloud like us that started using cloud for that matter. So we started using it as a remote storage server. The whole idea was to store the data in a remote location, so that as and when you want, you can just access the data. That was the whole idea when it was started, like store your files in the cloud. And how are we accessing them, by the way? So do you think I can upload my pictures or videos to iCloud when I just take a picture? No, right? I need internet connection. So without internet connection, we cannot think of anything in cloud, guys. Everything has to be there, and internet has to be there, by the way. Internet acts as a backbone between the end user or the organizations or client to the cloud infrastructure that we are using. So internet plays a very major role. That's the reason we say that in order to access something in cloud, we need internet. But the reverse statement is not true, guys. But anything that we access over internet is not the cloud. Okay, so we work from work sometimes. Usually, you know, the employees, you have the option, you have a privilege of working from homes. So you are in home now, but you're connecting to your office servers. But do you think that's the cloud? No, that's not the cloud. You are connecting to on-prem servers just over internet or a VPN connections, but that's not, you're using your own infrastructure, by the way. But when we are talking about cloud, okay, there are different clouds, just to go one step deeper, where we talk about public clouds and private clouds. Public cloud and private cloud. In public cloud, we talk about AWS. We talk about Azure. We talk about GCP. Okay. In private cloud, you know, you might have heard about OpenStack. Okay. And there are many other clouds, but VRA, these are things that I'm aware of, guys. We vRealize Automation Center, VRAC. Okay. So the difference is that in the public cloud, if you are the client, you don't own the hardware. You only have to rent them. You use their service just like Ola and Uber. Okay, you don't have to worry about monthly maintenance. You don't have to worry about fuel prices. Okay, you don't have to worry about the car, you know, prices, and you have the comfort. You just pay it and you get it. In the same way, when you are as a client, if say you want to build some applications, okay, and this application needs security, this application needs backup, this application needs high availability, this application needs kind of what network, or it needs a database. So if you want to build all of this on-prem, you are supposed to buy all of this, right? You need to buy physical servers, you need to buy licenses, you need to have a skill set. You know, the important of all to make sure you are building the right solution there. But, and maybe this may cost you, let's say, 1 crore rupees, a simple calculation. Okay, that's very less number though, but no problem. But the same thing, okay, I can get into AWS, I can spin up all what I'm talking here, like security, backup, high availability, network, and DBs within like 1 hour. 1 hour is okay, I'm just again giving you time, just a time frame, and my infrastructure is ready. And if I run this entire infrastructure for 2 hours, maybe I have to show a demo to my client and I have spinned it up, and I, after that, I just terminated them, I will have to pay only for 2 hours. Whereas if that's the case here, if at all I don't have an option of cloud, if I don't have the option of using the cloud, and if I have to showcase a demo to my client, and my investment is this, and after that, these servers might be unused, or I may use them for, you know, for different purpose, but they will be idle running in my data center. And apart from this, the additional burdens that I have is that, you know, the kind of security, the physical security to the server, and then power supply, AC, cooling, the square feet area on the data centers, right, racking them, monitoring them, right? So all of this is a kind of additional burden to the clients, whoever is maintaining their own physical data centers. But with the cloud, we are overcoming those challenges of, you know, we don't have to maintain the physical data centers, we don't have to worry about physical network, security, monitoring, right, licensing, high availability, fault tolerance, and then important of all, refreshment of hardware every 5 years. So we are just cutting the you know, operational expenses by using this cloud-based infrastructure, guys. And the spin up, you can actually spin up the infrastructure within no time, but that's not possible in your you know, physical data. That's the reason people are getting moving towards or leaning towards cloud for building their infrastructure. And sometimes people, when I ask questions, like people assume that what is cloud? They say that there is something virtual which doesn't exist, is what they say. They say it's a remote location. That's not true, guys. Very simple logic that I want to put here is, and you can respond to this. So what do you think the most important thing that we do in the, what is that we do for an organization, guys? Let's say suppose someone is hiring us. What is that we are doing? like right from L1, L2, L3, your managers, senior managers, okay, executives, principals, directors. What is their purpose in organizations? What are they working for? To make sure whatever that specific organization that you're working for, their applications or the support that you actually do are up and running, right? Everybody directly or indirectly, they are working towards making sure they are giving a better service to their clients. And that's by making sure their applications are up and running, irrespective of failures and all. So to run this application, what is that we need, guys? Operating systems, that's where the choice comes to us. It could be Windows or Linux. Okay. And then where does the operating system run, by the way? So in order to run the operating system, we need the hardware. So when we talk about hardware, we have different combinations of RAM, CPU, network, disk, right? And what if this one fails? We need to have the other. That means no matter what, so application is what we are trying to install, but to make sure this application is up and running, these are the things that we need to take care in the background. But in the back end, we need power, right? Cooling solutions, space, and then manpower to maintain it. Right, regular patches, updates, and everything has to be done. So this is the extra efforts that everyone is putting. But now, even when we talk about cloud, even in the cloud also, we are hosting our applications, right? So in order to make sure our application is running, this application needs what? Operating system. And it needs hardware. Now the point is, where does this hardware come from? This hardware comes from the physical servers that you have it in your data centers. So the only difference is that if you are installing your own applications in your own data centers, you will have to buy the physical servers, but you're still maintaining a data center. But when you are using cloud, the only difference is that you don't get to use your own data center. Rather, you are using someone's data center to build up your applications. That's the only difference. And you are paying a rent for them. But the rest of the things, the way the data centers are built, the way the data center has to be protected, the way the data center networking has to be defined, the way the communication has to go on, everything is the same. Nothing changes, guys. Okay. So when we say cloud, they are nothing but remote data centers, which are maintained by the provider that we are choosing. It could be AWS, Azure, GCP. There are so many now that came up into the market. That's what. When you say iCloud, when you are using Apple phones and then you are trying to save your data into iCloud, that's nothing but you are saving your pictures, your documents, all your phone data into Apple's data center. When you are using Android phones, you are storing them into Google's data center. When you are using Samsung or MI, their respective cloud vendors is what you use. And when we are using Amazon Web Services, we are relying on Amazon's data center. Got it? And it's Amazon's responsibility to give us the service, and they are taking the burden of maintaining the physical infrastructure, its high availability, fault tolerance, network, right? It is their responsibility. We are least bothered about it. Let's say suppose, you know, I'm getting into Uber, guys. So what is the difference between having our own car and Uber, by the way? So when we have our own car, it is our responsibility to first choose what is that we want. Okay, which car are we getting into? What is our budget? What is our monthly expenditure that we can spend on it? What is the mileage that gives us? What is the comfort that you're looking for? We need to plan all of this. Once you plan it, then you get into the market and you choose certain variant. And after you choose certain variant, you have to invest money first, right? A down payment is what you do. And after that, you pay the what we call the insurances, road taxes, blah, blah, and all, everything you do it, and then you get a car. After you get a car, it is your responsibility to take care of your car, right? know, someone has hit and you have to put it in the garage and make it, you know, fixed it, or the fuel prices, the traffic that you want to have, right? There are extra budgets. But and later on you realize that the car that you bought is not so comfortable with you. What is it you do? It's again a huge process, right? And at least someone will buy your you know, car, but physical hardware, that's not the case. But when you get into Ola or Uber, you have a choice now, right? You are going alone to an office, you have the choice of booking a share, right? You travel with other people so that you can reduce your you know, travel cost. Or you are going out for a party, just book a nice car. And then you are going out in a vacation for a, you know, with more family members, book a 7-seater. You have the flexibility to choose. And in these cases, do we really worry about the fuel prices? Do we really worry about the car insurance, the maintenance, road taxes? No, right? You are taking a service from some XYZ. The main purpose is to travel from one location to other location. You look into the comfort, you look into the discounts that you get, you look into the prices. Is it convenient to you? If not Uber, you will look into someone else. You have that privilege of getting from one vendor to other vendor, and whichever suits you, just get in there. So that is what a cloud mean here, guys. Okay, so here, there we are taking car as entity, but here we are talking like data center as an entity now. So when we talk about AWS, everything, it's their responsibility to buy the hardware, it's their responsibility to give us the infrastructure what we want, their high availability and everything, it is what they maintain. Our job is to build our applications. You use your application for 1 month, you pay for 1 month, use it for 1 year, you pay for 1 year. And based on your usage, they also can give you sustained discounts, okay, where you can save a lot of money too. That is how the cloud functions, guys. So since our main point here is to talk about AWS, okay, so AWS has started their service like infrastructure as a service. So with, I told you about public cloud and private cloud, and the main purpose, no matter what cloud you use, public or private, they are divided their services in different streams. One is IaaS, infrastructure as a service. Second is PaaS, which is platform as a service, and software as a service. So it all started with this infrastructure as a service. Now I want to hear from you guys. What do you think an infrastructure is? What is infrastructure?
Infrastructure means the all the computers or the servers, anything, and the network like ISP. And the physical hardware which we process, whatever, it will come under the infrastructure, along with the company main building maintenance and everything.
Okay, understood. Anyone want to try? Simple terms, guys. We don't want the you know, the fancy terms and all, but just to make others understand, I want the simple terms. You don't have to look for the actual definitions, by the way.
What we need, that is, daily, what we have to need for our actions and do some job.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anyone?
Resources that are required to host an application.
When I say, can you name some resources?
Yeah, maybe database.
Okay. So infrastructure in the sense, guys, you know, RAM, CPU, network, disk, right? Physical servers. That's what infrastructure is. Like I said, in order for application to run, like DB is also an application, right? In a simple terms, it's some service. But in order for this application or DB to run, we need operating system. This operating system is also a software layer. But in order for this operating system to run, we need the hardware. This is what infrastructure is. And the components that it supports for running this hardware, like physical power, network, right? High availability, fault, all of this contribute to the infrastructure, by the way, guys. So that is what infrastructure is. So when we say infrastructure, in simple terms, we can call it RAM, CPU, network, and disk. The whole idea is that these guys, this AWS started renting this so that you can build your own application. That is what we call infrastructure as a service. That's where they have started. And gradually now, undoubtedly, they are the leading service cloud provider in this world. And so it's the same thing. We have database, we have storage, we have network. Okay. But Amazon has named them quite differently, guys. Okay. Just to name few, you might have heard about them. But so computing power. Computing power is where, you know, you create your instances for running applications. Amazon doesn't call it that way. Amazon call it EC2. How many of you heard about this EC2?
No, I haven't heard.
No problem. So if you haven't heard, guys, no problem, but you're going to get comfortable with these terms. So the generic term that we use in IT industry, like as infrastructure guys, is that we say compute, but Amazon calls it EC2. Storage. Okay, there are different types of storages, guys. Amazon names them differently. There is a block storage, which is EBS, is what Amazon calls it. There is a file storage, right? These are the generic terms that we use in IT. Like block storage, file storage, but Amazon names them different. The services that they give is different. For file storage, they call it EFS. We have object storage. The generic term is object storage, but Amazon name for this specific service is S3. Networking. You know, when we talk about networking, we do creation of network, subnets, routing table, internet gateway, public IP, private IP, all of this. And they have a service called VPC, virtual private cloud. Okay. And databases. So, you know, we all know, guys, database plays a very important role. And we know how the database guys actually work on databases, right? So they do a lot of things where, you know, daily taking off their backups, performance tuning, patching. They do a lot of things. You know? They're very busy in fine tuning the database performance and all. So if you are given a task of, you know, you are joined very new to the organizations, you haven't touched the database, but you are given a task of, you know, hey, can you please build? It's very urgent. And even client knows that you are not experienced in it, but he wanted to build it in next 1 hour, 2 hour. A high available database, Oracle database. Do you think it is possible for you to do it in one hour, guys? Accepting the fact that you haven't worked on it before? Not really, right? Figuring out things, the dependencies, you know, installation of database is kind of very hectic, guys. Every package has to be matched, the sequence of package that you install, everything matters there. But when you get into cloud, I can do that within 5 minutes. The service called RDS, a high availability database. That means Amazon has taken over the manual burden that we actually do to save the time of the client. Okay, you don't have to worry about selection of operating system, what version. You can just go there into RDS, select drop down menu, and then you build it. That's it, you are done. Security, we need to protect it. There are different kinds of security that Amazon gives us. So all of these that you see on the screen are most widely used services, and they are given to you as ready-made services, guys. Imagine if you have to do the same thing on-prem, you have to invest huge amount of money. You buy a server. For security, you need to buy some security servers. Okay, for high availability, you need to buy more servers. Right, it's not that easy. For analytics, again, you have to buy licenses and then integrate with the existing one. But here in AWS, everything with just few clicks, you will be able to build a, you know, production grade applications with high availability, fault tolerance, and not compromising on the security or accessibility. And all at a price of what? Pay for what you consume or pay for what you use. Okay, any questions so far, guys? I'll take a pause here before we get further. Anybody, any questions so far?
Tell me once again for the database.
RDS. Relational Database Services. Okay, it is a PaaS service, platform as service, where Amazon will take care of all the installation, supplying of patch, backing up of your database is all handled by Amazon only. Got it?
Yeah, okay.
Yep.
Hi, this is Ravi. What about the developer tools and the analytics?
Yeah, so developer tools in the sense code commit, code build, right? Their IDEs, Python IDEs or .NET IDEs, Java IDEs. They have their own tools for building their own code and all.
Yeah, what about the specific the business applications which the clients request? Those also can be maintained in the AWS?
Can you name any?
SaaS.
Your voice is breaking, Ravi.
SaaS user analytics, some reporting tools.
Yeah, so
is it audible?
Yeah, it was breaking. I only heard few things, SaaS is what I heard, and then I lost it.
Some other reporting tools
XYZ. Okay, let it be XYZ tool that you have, any reporting tool like ZW, let's say example.
Yes.
You are aware of ZW, right? ZW Informatica.
Yes, correct. ZW Informatica, like that. Yeah.
Okay, so these are something which is not an AWS proprietary tool, right? They're third party tools that you want to use for your organization. Let's say suppose you are the architect now and your client wants to build the Informatica solution on top of AWS. So that's where I fall back to the same diagram that I shown you. Application could be anything. Like in our case, now it could be Informatica or it could be ZW. Okay, we need operating system. It could be Windows or Linux, your choice. You need a hardware, right? Like how much of memory, how much of CPU. So that's where we use computing, which is easy to, there is no ready-made solution available, by the way, but it's again, you have to build it. So there is a concept called AMIs, where a marketplace is what we call, where you can buy the ready-madely installed ZW servers. You can get it onto, you can import into your account, and then you can start building it, start using it. But for that, we use compute service, EC2.
Okay.
All right. So you'll understand all of this, guys, okay, when we talk about it. But yes, so anything that is not, so it's like, think from the infrastructure perspective. Let's say you are Informatica guy, okay, you're Informatica architect. I am infrastructure guy. Okay, we both are working the same company. How do we work together? You need RAM, CPU, network, and disk for installing your Informatica. You would come to me and say that, hey, Shiva, so we're trying to build the Informatica servers. Okay, we are trying to build Informatica a service in our organization. So I need this much of memory, this much of CPU, this much of network, this much of disk, okay, and with some operating system installed on top of it. My job is to give you that. After that, it's your job to get going with the installation process and building the Informatica infrastructure. Understood? And now we are going to understand why companies and individuals started using, getting into cloud. We already discussed that, but just to have a glimpse of how they work usually. So how is the cloud different from what has been used in the past? What are we using in the past? On-premise data centers. The example that I gave you, right? So that is high availability and fault tolerance. high availability, right? Say, you know, you are in home, by the way, and you have stored some files in your local device here, and you are out now. Do you think you will be able to access your data which is on your local computer from outside your network? A file and some document is missed out, you are going on interview, a document is missed and you want it to be there with you, but you don't have it. So will you be able to get it from your local desktop which is in your home? No, right? You will have to ask your brother or someone to just mail it to your, you know, email, and then you can take a printout of it. But when you store the data in the cloud, no matter where you are, you will be able to access your data, right? And it is not specific to any device. You can access it on the mobile phone, you can access it on your local PC, your friend's PC, or any device that has internet connection, you will still be able to access it. That is one thing, high availability. And let's say your device has been failed, like I said again, your mobile has been failed, but you have a cloud account, you want to still access your data, you can just get a brand new thing, or you can use any device, XYZ device, and then get connected to your account and start accessing the data, isn't it? So this is what they give you, guys, high availability and fault tolerance. So it gives you better sharing options, better backup options and all, and because of which you will be getting a high availability and fault tolerance. But before I go further, could someone tell me what is the difference between a high availability and a fault tolerance? Some assume both are the same. Okay, both are not same, by the way.
Hi Shiva. High availability means we do have all the resources for performing the application, like enough space, enough RAM, and everything. In the case of fault tolerance, it is that if we have a, for example, if we take a website like IRCTC, if we have a multiple number of hits at the same time, the machine should be active to take number of hits, not to get delay or something else like failure of loading the page or something else. These all comes under the fault tolerance.
Okay. So much of terms, people not aware might hearing for the first time might be confused. Okay.
I'm from a Windows background, that's the reason.
No problem, understood.
Any
thoughts?
Yeah, in terms of, let's say if we receive high load, so if our production goes down, so there should be another environment where we can divert our traffic, so we call it as a disaster recovery environment.
Mm-hmm.
So it comes under high availability.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have any idea about fault tolerance.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Let me tell you in a simple terms, guys. High availability, minimal downtime. Fault tolerance, no downtime. Understood? Minimum downtime. No downtime. In both the cases, failure is common. Okay, like let's talk about this. Like say you have a website, okay, and people are reaching out to your website. This is one server, okay, server one only. For some reason, this is down. The reason could be anything. It could be physical server failures, OS level failures, or the service level failures, or application itself is failed. In this case, will the users be able to access our website? If it is a failure, guys, will they be able to access our website?
No.
Now, how do I overcome it? I should have what?
One more server, and they should present in a cluster.
One more server. It doesn't have to be in a cluster, by the way.
It should be
up and running. It doesn't have to be in a cluster. It can be anything, right? So now, this defines, there are two chances here. One is active, other is active-passive.
Passive.
It could be anything. Let's say if it is active, one and two are active. In this case, people simultaneously, like they can use it as a load balancers too. Okay, the request will go for both. If any time this one fails, my second request also go to the second. So now this is there to take off my jobs, right? And let's say this one also failed. Now in this case,
obviously no availability, right?
Obviously no availability. Okay, let me just expand this further. And this is in one region, by the way. This is in one region, let's say Mumbai. The entire Mumbai is down now. Like someone talked about disaster recovery. I have my data center running in Pune. Okay. In this case, what happens? Maybe if people are not reaching out to Mumbai, now my application has to come up live in Pune data centers and they should be able to access it. What is the difference? Now, what is the time that it took for my service to go from the failed service to the active service? 0 minutes or 0 seconds. So as an end user, they don't know. Like we access Google, right? Have you ever seen Google going down? Have you ever seen Facebook going down? That doesn't mean that the failures are not there in the data center. Failures are very common. You know, when we are running on a physical infrastructure, the server might go wrong, the CPU might get corrupted, the network might go wrong, then something, right? Something might go wrong very often. And it's not that, you know, there are some gods and all, they're maintaining without failures. No. But they have built the infrastructure in such a way that such failures are not impacting their services. That is what we call fault tolerance, zero downtime. When we say minimal downtime, we know that, okay, server is down. Okay, let's wait for 5 minutes. It will be up now, no matter what. So within 5 minutes, but the 5 minute disruption is there to you. Right? And after 5 minutes, the service is up and running. That is what we call high availability. So when we say our infrastructure is highly available, accepting the fact that, okay, there will be some downtime at some point of time, but we are okay with it. But boss, I need a infrastructure with fault tolerance, which means not even a second or a couple of seconds of downtime is acceptable. That is going to cost me huge sum. Got it? So here, this environment, I can say it has a fault tolerance because the failure has happened, but still I'm able to access it. But the DR solution is just a high availability thing. I know there is a downtime now. Let's wait for like a couple of hours and I'll get the infrastructure up and running on the other region. Understood?
Yeah, got it. Sure.
We'll discuss further, guys. No worries. When we get into the topics and all, we discuss this just to give you an idea of it. And enterprises. You can see here, you know, a simple chart. Like in 2016, you know, there is a company, XYZ company. Let's take Zomato or, you know, WeChat. WeChat would be the right example. No, is anyone using WeChat, by the way? We have WhatsApp and we have WeChat. Okay, so WhatsApp was the first thing that came up, and later people started using WeChat, and they started with good numbers, let's say 1,000 users, and they made their infrastructure ready for them. Like, you know, their architect, chief architect, told that, okay, for maintaining 1,000 users, since we are starting, 3 servers should be fine. And they got very good response, and the architect has planned that, okay, boss, in 2017 our user base is going to increase to 5,000. Okay, let's buy additional 3 servers to meet up to the demand. They bought it and they thought like 4 times the growth in 1 year. Okay, 1,000 to 5,000, and they estimated that in 2018 the users are going to get 4 times more. and the estimator for what? 20,000 users. But to accommodate 20,000 users, shouldn't they need the physical servers, guys? Yes, right? They need physical servers. They need to buy. So they need to procure them. They need to get them onto the data centers, connect them, bring them up live. Then they are able to accommodate the request. But things went upside down. Okay. They procured the hardware, they did everything. But the user base came up to only 7,000. Now, what is happening to the rest of the server? This is very common situation that we face, guys, in when we are maintaining the data centers, right? So people will think twice, thrice, multiple times before they actually procure the hardware. Okay, they need to show the actual business case to the financials and all. Okay, it's not that easy. It involves a lot of huge investment on the buying servers and all. So in this case, how are they overcoming it? And then that's to wait. No matter you use it or you don't use it, the moment you get that procured to your data center, and then the warranty or guarantee starts, and it has lifespan of 5 years. After 5 years, the warranty is gone and they are not suitable to run things in a production environment. But this is, that means scalability is there, but elasticity is a problem. Scalability is what? From 3 you went to 6, from 6 you went to kind of like almost 20 servers, like 6 6 12, like 16 servers, 17 servers. This is what scalability. So scalability is available in on-prem, but elasticity, when there is no demand, you cannot get hold of, you cannot get remove the unused services in your unused servers in data center. But that's not the case in cloud, right? You have scalability and you have elasticity. So from 1,002 users to 4,000 users, you have 4 servers, you came back to 3,000, and you will pay only for 3 servers. You are removing the unwanted servers that you have it here. So 2 to 4 is a scalability, and 4 to 3 is an elasticity. Okay. So the other two main pillars of cloud, why enterprises are getting into cloud, is scalability and elasticity. So where, you know, that's where we use a service called auto scaling. You know, the big billion day, those who are in India, at least you must be remembering the Flipkart's first big billion day was flop, because they didn't expect that so many users would actually log into their websites, and server went down, the orders were not placed properly, the orders got exchanged. Okay, because they didn't expect that much of load, and they are not ready for that. But if you are putting them in cloud now, at least, you know, you don't have to be there. Okay, for 1,000 users, you just write a condition, 2 servers. Okay, if the users are increasing, provision more servers. If the users are decreasing, delete the servers. Now, at any point of time, you will pay only for the servers you're running. Let's say, suppose you have used these 2 servers for 2 hours, 4 servers for, you know, like say 6 hours, and 3 servers for 10 hours. For 10 hours, you will be charged only for 3 servers. For 4 servers, you will be charged only for 6, like this. So at a given hour, the number of servers that you have only will be charged. It's not that, okay, used 4 in today and you will have to pay for 4 the rest of the month and all. No, that's not the case. Okay. So that's a very simple conversation or discussion that we had, guys, just to make sure we are getting onto the same page, those who are not aware of the concepts and all. But like I said, this session is more of your session. Okay, you might have some questions in your thoughts, and I am here to clarify those things. But just to get started, I have set the context here. Now it's your turn, guys. Any question that you have, okay, maybe next half an hour, 45 minutes. It will be you will be asking questions and I'll be answering them. You can get started.
Hi. See, if at all any database are running on Oracle servers, how to migrate to AWS, like any?
We have process? The predefined migration services available. Okay. So there are different ways, by the way. I should not tell you one way. There are multiple ways depending on the use case, depending on the kind of migration that you're trying to do. We can use it, but Amazon has a very simple migration services available. The simple way is that take the backup of your existing database, put it on S3, and then import into the Amazon RDS.
Okay. Is it like a lift and shift kind of thing?
Yes, we have lift and shift. We have the direct synchronization.
Okay.
Okay, that's what I told you, right? Depending on the use case, you can choose, but everything is supported. Depending on your needs, you can choose the service that best suits you.
Sure, Ravi here.
Go ahead, Ravi.
So at the end of this course, we would be in a position to migrate the native-based application, like any web application or what are the current application, to cloud? Or there's something extra we need to go apart from this curriculum?
So I can give you the idea of migrating the applications from on-prem to cloud, like the different services that we have, the approaches that we do. Again, the migration strategy changes from the kind of application to application, right? The scenario to scenario. So this course specifically doesn't cover that things, but out of interest, I can give you that scenarios, and I can share you a couple of blogs where you can get this information.
Okay, fine. So you would be covering the basic things on the migration, right? If I'm not wrong.
Yes.
Okay. So, and also I see on the certification panel, the first slide, when the session has started, there was three certificates saying DevOps, System Admin, Architect, Associate, and DevOps Engineer, I believe. Can you please clarify what would be the difference in this? At the end of the session, we would be in an architect, right? If I'm not wrong.
Yes, true. So basically, depending on the roles, guys, right, you know, Amazon has segregated the skill set and the kind of services that we use. So that is, you know, you can see on my screen now, there are three level associate level exams: solution architect, developer, sysops. Okay. And followed by the professional certificates. There is solution architect professional and DevOps engineer professional. So you know DevOps, right? DevOps is more of you know, building the CI/CD pipelines, automating things and all. So for that, Amazon believes that you need to have some kind of developer skill set, because in DevOps we are going to use developer tools like deployment tools or code commit, version controlling systems and all. So if for some time being, let's not talk about developers. Now, simple thing, architect. Who is an architect, guys? Who do we call an architect? The person who builds it, right? Yes or no? Whoever is building new thing.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, building. So when he is trying to build something as an architect, his job is to understand the client needs, what is the expenditure, what is the budget that he has, what is that he's looking for, what is the end goal, that why he's want to getting into cloud. And based on his thoughts, the client detail that he shares, architect job is to build the infrastructure, kind of blueprint that he builds. Okay, now the web server should be here, the DB should be here. If this goes down, the other server will come into picture. This is how we do it. End users are going to access it. This is where I'm going to store my log. These kind of architecting things and building of that for the very first time is all taken care of by the architect. And once it is built, the job of architect is done, guys. Next thing is what? Day-to-day maintenance. Okay, let's say suppose you are also an AWS architect. You are working for XYZ company. You are their own employee. I'm an AWS architect. I come to you. I take requirement from you. I build the infrastructure for you and I'll just go away. I'll take a sign off and I'll go away. After that, it's your responsibility to maintain the infrastructure, day-to-day activities, taking backups, monitoring, reducing the price, creation of instances, creation of new infrastructure, right? That is all taken care by whom? System operations guy. That is sysops administrator is what we call. This is more of day-to-day activities that you do in AWS after you have the infrastructure built. Okay, so developer is more of a customization. Let's say I have a policy now. I want to write a policy which will restrict the access to certain services. Maybe that policy is not available by default in AWS. You may have to write it, like it use JSON script, something that you have to write it. Building the APIs for communication from one service to other service. They can use .NET, they can use Java. So those are something that we talk about developers. So here in the course, okay, we will be covering 100% of Solution Architect Associate, where you will be able to clear the certification if you are following along with me and reading all the content that I'm going to share with you and tell you. You will be able to clear the certifications. But clearing the certification is not our motto, right? And I believe, like, once we are done with the course, maybe after a couple of months of practice, you might have to put some experience, like maybe, you know, 2+ years of experience onto AWS, or 1.5 years, 2 years. How are we matching to that level? SysOps has to be there. So I will be covering the major concepts of SysOps, okay, which has to be explained, and the rest you will understand by yourself. And few developer concepts also should be discussed. So now, our course includes a combination of developer as well as SysOps associate and 100% of Solution Architect Associate, guys. Understood? But for, if you want to get into like DevOps engineer in AWS, you will have to clear the certification of developer or SysOps. But if you want to become a Solution Architect Associate, I mean professional, and then this one has to be cleared. Apart from this, they have some specialty exams, which is network specialty, security specialty, Hadoop, big data specialist, and all. And whichever is your choice, you can choose.
Hi, Shiva. Good evening.
Good evening, Shailaja.
Sorry, it's morning for you, I know. I understand the concept of about what is what, but my question is, do somebody need a coding and programming skills to learn this AWS?
See, two things. To learn AWS, you don't need any coding.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And when you're applying for the job, it depends on what role you're applying for. That's okay. Where coding comes into picture. I know this is a very common question that, and common confusion that everybody has. Let's say, suppose I have decided to be an AWS architect, and AWS itself is hiring me, okay, and they say that they are looking for Solution Architect Associate.
Yeah.
This is the job description. In this case, you can clear, like, your, let's say that's what you're preparing for, you can clear your Solution Architect Associate, your SysOps Associate, and then your Solution Architect Professional Exam without knowing even the spelling of code. Also, you can complete them. You can become a master there.
Oh, okay.
So if you're getting into DevOps now, things become a bit tricky. In DevOps, you will have to write some sample codes, like pipelines you have to write in, where you use YAML. That's very simple, by the way, but you should be aware of it. It doesn't have to be Java code. It doesn't have to be .NET code. Any code which you have to write for letting these services do what they want. Usually in DevOps, we talk about pipelines, and we talk about infrastructure as a code, where why should I deploy the same EC2 instance multiple times with next and finished? I want to automate that. I may have to use services like CloudFormation. I may have to use services like Terraform. In that case, I'll have to write a code. Again, it's YAML, very easy. Get my point? For learning, you don't need a code, but when you are putting some experience and saying that, okay, you are a DevOps engineer and all, you need to have some exposure to writing a code, guys. And that code is not something Java or .NET. It's infrastructure as a code, which is very, very simple to learn or to implement.
Okay, my another question is, I don't want to become an architecture, but I'm interested for SysOps. So you have to take the whole training, as is it a different training for that?
Yes. Now, next question to you again. How are you going to maintain the infrastructure if you don't know the architecture itself?
Oh, okay. It's a link, like we have to learn this, then go there. Okay.
True.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much.
Yep. Any questions, guys?
Hi, Shiva. What is the time frame for this training? like in my case, I'm a functional guy, but I just need to understand the high level concept. So I'm interested in solutions architect training. And if possible, I'd like to clear the certification. So what would be the time frame? Learning as well, like how much time individually I need to spend.
Okay, so I think 60 hours of study should be sufficient for you, but which includes my training sessions as well as your study too. Okay, and the session would be approximately for 35 to 40 hours. Okay, you can divide that into days, by the way. And so, like I said, alone solution architect itself is like kind of 27 or 25 hours, I should say. If you just skim it down, it should be 25 hours. But we are including both developer as well as some concept of SysOps. Additional 10 to 15 hours would be add as an extra to it. So it will take around 1.5 months for us to complete these sessions. And after that, like 20 days of the study, the, again, recapping of everything, you should be good to write the exam too.
Thanks, Shiva.
Yeah.
Hey, Shiva, Shravant here. I'm front-end developer. I'm not like aware of any kind of back-end stuff or not even DevOps stuff. Are you guys like going to deal with this from scratch or how the training will start?
Is yes, Revant, I think you understood right. My first statement was believing there are people with no IT background or different backgrounds as well. Yes. So when I deliver things, you guys are in my thoughts. Okay. And I'll try to put as simple as possible so that you understand. So things, I'll take up things from a very basic level to the advanced concept. So you should be able to follow along. You should not face any issues.
Okay.
Hi, Shiva.
Yashwant, go ahead.
Hi, Shiva. Actually, currently I'm working on Windows and we are using VMware for accessing our application and everything right now. And we are going to migrate to AWS. And how this course is helping me to migrate my servers to AWS and all these things?
So I did this like 3.5 years back, okay, where I have migrated applications from VMware to AWS. So when you're doing so, like, you know, without knowing things, how are you going to work on it, right? You cannot just do a kind of next and finish, right? So that's how the migration, that's how Amazon has done, by the way. And if you look into the integrations of VMware with AWS, that's what you do. Next finish, your application is going to migrate seamlessly. But what is happening there? You need to understand how are the communication happening? How are you making your infrastructure highly available? How are you protecting it? How are you securing it? Right, how are you applying the backups to it? These concepts you need to be aware of.
Thanks, Shiva.
Yep.
Hi, Shiva, this is Banu.
Yeah, Banu.
Yeah, as Shravan said, I was from mainframe background. I don't know anything, so that's what I also want to from scratch.
Come again, sorry, I missed it.
Yeah, I came from mainframe background. I don't know about AWS and everything. So I want to change from my mainframes to AWS guy.
We can do it. Yeah. We can do it, guys. Your efforts are important here. Okay, I'm here to tell you the concepts in a simple terms, make you understand the concepts, and then you have to spend some extra time comparatively with other guys. So coming hailing from, I have trained multiple people, so many people from mainframes, you know, mainframes has now stopped, right? There is no growth before. So you have to spend some extra time comparatively with other people, an extra hour to make sure you are going to compete with them. But that shouldn't be a problem. We can do it.
Sure. Thank you.
Hello, Siva.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm working in a government organization. I want to move to private company. How can I keep this experience in a government organization? For example, you are saying you have to keep 2+ years of experience in AWS and this everything. How can I show that experience in the government organization? I have 5 years of experience in government, and last also I have government experience.
What is that? You don't want to put government experience at all?
No, I want to keep experience, but how can I keep this AWS experience in that I am asking?
So if you apply for a job in my company, I'm not going to get into your organization and ask what have you done there, right? You should be confident in telling that you have worked on this.
But in our organization, it is not there. That's why.
Who knows
how can
it?
We keep
Who
it in the resume?
It? Who knows it?
Okay.
I don't know, right?
Okay.
See,
but in, while
you are working for
internal...
XYZ. You are working for XYZ. What you do there, I don't really bother. But you tell me that you worked on it, I interview you. And if your interview is going well, then why will I have to doubt that? What
you
do
you will, will teach everything on this experience level, everything. Project
yes,
also,
exactly.
I should give the particular project I have to show, no? That I have worked on this particular project, I built this project.
Yeah,
how
yeah.
can we show?
We'll work on that. Work on that. No problem.
Okay.
Hello, Shiva. Is it, this is Chandrasekhar.
Hello, Chandrasekhar.
Actually, non-IT related.
What is that? Hegar, I missed it.
Actually, I worked in non-IT related work, and
okay.
I need to shift that into AWS. Is this possible?
Yes, guys, everything is possible in IT. But you know, when you say that you are from non-IT and different things, my suggestion would be like you have to spend some extra hours in learning. Now, see, the things are like architect. Let me put this very simple.
Yeah,
so
you have
been the
explained
depth of
three
it.
Roles. No? You have been explained three roles: architect, developing,
yes.
and yes, yes.
Yeah. So traditionally. If before cloud era, like, you know, before cloud, there was no cloud concepts at all. Who used to be an architect? Any idea? A guy with minimum 16 plus years to 20 plus years of experience guy used to be an architect. How many agree to this?
Yeah, myself.
Right. That means this
yes.
guy with this much of experience has undergone multiple job roles. He might have started as a, you know, L1 guy or a networking guy, gradually or desktop guy, and gradually he got into servers, he got into network, he got into databases, he got into, you know, managing high availability, maybe security. That means he has overcome, that means he has seen all the components in a data centers and he got a hands-on experience on all of those. An application behavioral, right? How do we install application? Then he becomes an architect, isn't it?
Okay, exactly.
Now in cloud, you do a solution architect associate, you are an architect, no matter what your experience is. But to meet up to that level, you should be doing something else. Like, you know, I see people are developers, at least they worked on some contributing to application, they know the how the application works. So what I believe is some basic things like Linux is mandatory. We don't specially tell that, you know, you need to learn Linux, but when you are saying that you're a solution architect associate, you worked on some applications. This application needs some operating system. Linux is what we are choosing there, right? You need this. Some networking background, like how the networking is built, some high availability, some applications also you should be aware of, because what have you architected on AWS is what you need to showcase in the interview, right?
Okay.
So these are the things that you need to additionally spend your time in learning. But yes, it's not impossible. Like I said, if you're spending like 2 hours on so understanding the AWS concepts, spend additional 1 hour in learning Linux or networking basics and application concepts and all. Then you should be good enough to apply for a job.
Okay.
Understood?
Hi.
Okay.
Shiva, sorry to interrupt you. Hi, Al. A small info from Career IT. A batch is starting from tomorrow onwards, that is 20th June, IST time. And the regular session timings are from 6:30 to 7:30 a.m. IST. So please, if you have any, okay, if you need any other details, please do reach us on the numbers. Our mail ID, whatever I have provided in chat. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Hi, Shiva.
Hi, can you write me?
Yes, please. Yashwant, tell me.
Are there any other timings other than 6:30 to 7:30?
As of now, we have only one slot, Yashwant. 6:30 to 7:30.
Actually, my office is at 8 o'clock. Actually, my office is at 8 o'clock and I need to start from my home at minimum 7 o'clock to reach the office. So, any other
You are from India only? You are from India only?
I'm from India. I'm from India.
Okay. Okay, I'll talk to you, Yashwant. Okay, I'll talk to you anyway today. I'll call you, okay? And I'll talk to you.
Sure.
Because, yeah, sure. Thank you.
Yeah, same case with people from India, because that's the time, you know, people go to work or kids leave to school. That time is pretty much occupied for most of us in India. Also, I have a question for Shiva.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is Priyanka. So if someone is interested in DevOps engineering, in clearing that certification, so they have to complete this solution architect course, of course. And then additionally, what else they have to learn? Like, is that provided by you on top of this course? Or is it a different route?
It's a different, no, I don't say it's a different route, guys. So what happens is that once you are aware of solution architect associate, this is what I always suggest to people. You don't have to get into any further training, okay? So with solution architect associate, you have a good hands-on experience of wide variety of services. You know in and out of the services. So you need to spend some time in preparing for the curriculum that they are giving you. When we talk about DevOps, like they talk about, you know, blue-green deployments, they talk about you know, application deployment services, they talk about high availability, they talk about upgrades, they talk about automation. So those services are available to you. You can start exploring them by getting into the documentation, reading them and doing it. That's one way of getting into that. Otherwise, you know, I can do it, but we don't have a regular sessions on those, you know, trainings, I should say. But I can guide you. If that's what you're looking for, I can tell you where you can actually look into for what is that, how is that you have to prepare and all. I can guide you on those things. Not a problem.
Okay. Thank you. Can I also know a little bit about fee structure?
That they will get back to you, Priyanka. I think the organizer will talk to you on that.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Yeah. Hi, Shiva. This is Ravi. I'm currently working as a backend developer. Here you mentioned the six roles. Which role is suitable for me for this course?
So, guys, see, when you are applying for the jobs, you don't get to see a role like SysOps engineer or a professional solution architect professional. That is just a skill set. Okay. Ultimately, you'll end up in a job either you are a DevOps engineer or a cloud engineer. That's it.
Okay. Here, do you want to learn any new languages for either developing things here, AWS?
So, you know, like I said, development is not our motto here. Our motto is automation. Infrastructure as a code is what we are looking into. So this infrastructure as a code can be achieved by different services. So when we talk about AWS natively, there is a service called CloudFormation. And people expect when you're applying for Amazon interviews or cloud in AWS cloud engineers, okay, when you say that you are a AWS architect, they expect that you know this CloudFormation service. This is an automation service within Amazon. This service uses two languages. One is YAML, yet another markup language, and the JSON, a JavaScript. This is what you need to be aware of.
Okay, I'm not aware of the Java. Yeah, you mentioned the JSON. JSON is required from the Java skills here.
Yes. No, not Java skills. The syntax is different. It's a JavaScript oriented language is what we call. So you don't need Java for that. Trust me, guys. Okay, if someone is afraid of coding here and I am your side, okay, I am not a coding guy though, but AML is something which is very easy. I feel comfortable writing AML code. Okay, it is very easy. Anybody can learn it. Very simple. Okay, you have.
Can you spell it?
What is that?
Can you spell YAML? YAML, right?
Yes, YAML. YAML, at another markup language. This is what you need to know as a coding part. And even Ansible, you might have heard about Ansible. Ansible also uses YAML.
So, will you cover the both languages in this course?
Yes, I can show you guys. See, we are not learning YAML or JSON here, but I'm going to show you how CloudFormation will work. We take some sample code. I'll explain you the code, how it works and all, and then I'll be deploying it. We are not learning language here, by the way. But the syntax, how do you get the code, from where you can get the code, everything, you will be knowing it.
We need to keep our extra efforts in learning those, right?
True. Yes.
Actually, I'm a completely operations guy in VMware. I do only know Linux, and these YAML and all are the new technologies for me. So, will those be very easy for me to learn, or I need to keep some more extra efforts other than this?
No, since you are from the VMware background and all, you should not face any issues. You should be good to go. It will be cakewalk for you, at least. Whoever has some infrastructure skill set, virtualization concepts and all.
Thank you, Shiva.
Yep. Any questions, guys?
You mean this course goes with for 2 months? The course duration?
Yeah, 6 months to 7 weeks. Sorry, 6 weeks to 7 weeks.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Shiva, is there any hands-on during the course? Is it required to clear the exam?
Exam is theoretical exam.
Okay.
So choose the choice, multiple choice questions is what the exam is. So that's a tricky thing here, AWS guys. Why AWS exam? People say, you might have, if you talk to your friends who has done it or in the market, the general talk is Amazon exam is not so easy. Okay, so there are two kinds of people, guys. Usually, a guy with good hands-on experience, you give them many tasks, they are ready to do it and they can do it within no time. But these exams are not that. These exams are multiple choice questions. They're scenario based questions. They give you some real time scenario and you need to understand that and you have to choose the right answer, for which you should be aware of the practical as well as theoretical content as well. If you are theoretically good, if you have no practical exam, you cannot clear the exam. If you're practically good and theoretically you're not strong, you cannot clear the exam. Both has to be balanced for these exams. That's the reason people, they miss this logic and people say that, AWS is tough, you cannot clear the exam and all. But if you are balancing both theoretically as well as practically, you should be able to clear the exam. Got it?
Shiva, one more thing. And we need to have an account on AWS, right? And we need to purchase some course modules over there. And you will be explaining them which modules we need to be purchased.
Yes,
and everything
will be explained. The account is free of cost.
Account is free of cost, but the modules which we require,
yes,
and the database which we require, that is that we need to pay and we need to use.
Nothing is, everything is free. Like, at least in our case, 99.99% of the services can be used for free of cost without paying a single NP.
Okay.
I'll talk about those limitations, how to use them. Okay, as and when it comes in the session. Okay.
Sure.
Yep.
So we are not only learning theory, we are learning a live project also simultaneously?
True. Yes. It's right away, guys. 2 years of experience, what you can put up after the sessions.
Okay. Oh, cool. Okay. Thank you.
That's it. Yep. Anything else? Anyone? Okay, guys, if no questions, maybe we can disperse. I think, thank
One
you.
One more
for
question, last and final question, sir.
Yes,
last and final question. Will you be providing us the material or the dumps which are required for the clearing of the written exam, AWS?
I have the old dumps, guys. Okay, I don't have the latest dumps because Amazon constantly changes the dumps and all. But trust me, if you are reading, those dumps will help you understanding the pattern of the exam. Like there are around 450 questions, I believe.
Okay.
So things has to come from that, but they frame questions differently, but the content would be the same.
Okay. And you will be making us to prepare for them.
Yes. I'll be telling you the concepts, what kind of questions you can expect when we're talking about those things. Okay. What is that you have to read to understand better and all, we'll be talking as and when the services comes.
Thanks, Shiva.
Thank you, yep. Shiva. Thank you for everything.
Thank you all, guys. Hope you enjoyed this session and see you all in the sessions. We'll meet tomorrow.
Okay.
Yep, thanks.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, Shiva.
Thank you, guys.
Hello.
Yeah.